I just want to say my disclaimer is this review I made, I've been using it for the past couple of semesters. It's possible that there's some mistakes on it, but again, I've been using it for 3 semesters and nobody's complained of a mistake, so. Also, this is what I think is going to be a good representation of what's going to be on your test. So like I told the people that were in here before, I'm going to spend about an hour on this, an hour and 15 minutes, and then we'll go ahead and go over test questions if you guys want to, or we can keep going on this. I think this is a good representation of all the concepts in 2040, though. So, that being said, yes. This is on the Study Union WordPress site, so if you Google Study Union WordPress, or it's the site, I think, is studyunion.wordpress.com. Click on chemistry, find my name, Sean, and then there it is. Okay? Awesome. It's kind of a purplish site. I made this site too, so. It's not the best site on the planet, but hey. Anyway. I have a blank copy here, so we're going to go ahead and start on this review packet. Also, I'm not going to be solving this like straight through. I'm going to be asking you guys questions on the different things, so please participate. Please have your calculators out, and please have scratch paper out, because I don't want to be punching all the numbers in my calculator. Cool? All right, let's go ahead and get started. So the first question says, you can see that, which perfect. Write the formula for a compound between potassium and sulfur. So how do we do that? First step is to what? Yes. Yeah, write their symbols. Perfect. So which one goes in the front? Potassium or sulfur? Sulfur. Potassium or sulfur. What? Potassium, good. And its symbol is what? K. And we have sulfur. What's its symbol? S, good. So we can eliminate these. So how do we figure out the ratios which they combine? How do we know? Yes. Write their charges, good. You don't have to raise your hand, just yell it out. What's the charge on potassium? Plus one, good. How do you know? Periodic table, perfect. What about sulfur? Minus what? Minus two, good. Or two minus, whatever it is. So we're going to go ahead and write this. We need two of these to cancel out with the two with the negative two charge on this. So it's going to be K2S. Cool? All right, let's keep going. Also, if ever you can't see that, let me know, because the thing is under my paper, and it's the dumbest design ever, so there you go. All right, which is not a salt? So what's a salt? And not table salt. I know what that is. Salt. A compound between what? Good, a metal and a non-metal. So let's take a look at what it is. So we have metal and non-metal, metal and non-metals, metal and a non-metal, metal and a non-metal. Which is the oddball? We have this one, right? Which is HCl. What type of compound is that? Acid, good. So this is an acid, and what's its name? Good, hydrochloric acid. C-L-O-R-I-C, but anyway. Hydrochloric acid. Cool? Next one. Yes?
Are there any exceptions to the rule of non-metals and metals?
For salts?
Yeah.
Salts are just non-metals and metals. That, yeah, they're just non-metals and metals. Look for something that's not one of those or an acid. Cool? All right. Calculate work energy W gained or lost by the system when a gas expands from 15 liters to 35 liters against a constant external pressure of 1.5 atmospheres. How do we do this? What formula am I going to use? Work. Good. Work equals what? Q plus H? Yes? Does everybody agree? What does work equal? I heard it. Negative P delta V. Good? So pressure is in units of what? Atmospheres? Yes, does everybody agree? It has to be in units of, what do we want our end unit to be in? What are the end units here? These are in kilojoules. So we want it in, so pressure, we're given a conversion factor. 1 liter per atmosphere equals 101 joules. Okay? So we need this in joules, pressure. So we can convert 101 point, it's 0.3, but to approximate for this question, an atmosphere equals 101.3 joules. That's joules per atmospheric liter. So we're going to go ahead and convert pressure. So 1.5 times 101. And how do we find delta V? Initial minus final, or final minus initial? Final, which is what? 35? Minus initial, which is what? Yes, no? 15? Does everybody agree with what I did so far? I see some faces. How do you find P? Good question. How do I find P? Huh? Convert it. Good. Pressure has to be in what? Units of what? What? Joules. Good. We need to end in joules. So what does this come out to be when you multiply it out? 154.5? 151? Hang on. Okay. What did I just do? Oh yeah. So we have work equals negative P delta V. I promised I solved this before. All right. What do we have to convert to 101 joules besides that? What do we have to convert? What? 1.5 to joules. Does everyone agree with that? I'm counting on you guys. I want you guys to find my mistakes. So what? Okay. What does it come out to be? Yes, 3039. And what is that answer in? Joules? Let's take a look at what we did. So we have, I need more space. Hold on. So we have, let me find one that's not double-sided. Okay. We have work equals negative P delta V. We know 1 liter times atmospheres equals 101 joules. We want work in units of joules or energy. Okay? We have a volume, which is our delta V. So we have delta P. So let's look. Work equals negative P. Yes. Negative P, what are our units of pressure? Joules. Good. We can't leave it in atmospheres. Why? What will it end up as? It'll be some weird unit, right? Yes. So if we multiply 1.5, which is our atmospheres from the question, times 101.3 joules per atmospheric liter, times our delta V, which is 20, right? 35 minus 15,
negative out front, what does that come out to be? Times 20 equals 3045 joules, negative, okay? What is that in kilojoules? Negative 3.045 kilojoules. What is that in sig figs? How many sig figs do we have to keep? We have two here. This is two because 35 minus 15, two sig figs. So minus 3.0 kilojoules. Cool? My what? Oh, it's on the UCF Study Union website. Okay? We good on this? Is that one of the answer choices? Yes, it is. 3.0 kilojoules. Negative 3.0 kilojoules. Okay? Let's move on. What is the mass in grams of calcium ion, Ca2+, is present in 3.102 grams of Ca3PO4? How do we do this problem? So what we're going to do for this problem is we have a mass. We're looking for the mass in grams of calcium ions present in that much. And we already were given our molar mass, so there's our first step. Second step we have to do is calculate how much calcium is in this compound. Okay? So how much calcium, how do we find how much calcium, what is the mass of calcium in this compound? How do we find the molar mass of anything? Periodic table, good. What's the mass of calcium from the periodic table? 40.07? 40.07. And this is in grams per molar, AMU. How many are there of calciums? There are three of them. Times three. What's 40 times 3? 4 times 3 is 12, so 120 or so. So in one mole of this compound, there are 120 grams of calcium. Okay? So we're just going to set up a simple proportion. Over 310.18, this is our molar mass of the whole compound, equals what we have, which is 3.102 under x grams. Okay? So when you cross multiply and divide, you should come out with, I think it's 1.200. Does everybody see what I did there? So what I did was I took the whole molar mass of this compound, I figured out how much calcium is in one mole of this, then I'd set up a ratio to figure out how much is in that amount of that compound. Okay? Question, yes. Yeah. Yes, I can write with a thinner pen. You see, two semesters ago, I got complaints of writing with a regular pen, so I went to a Sharpie, and now I'm going back, I guess. All right, so what I, can everybody read that? Kinda? No? This is a one. All right, it's 120 grams, which is the mass of what? 12. This is the mass of calcium in this compound. There are three calciums. The molar mass is 40.07. I multiplied it by 3. Over the total molar mass, which is 310.18 grams, equals, we have our mass that we're given, which is 3.102 under the one we're looking for. Okay?
There is. You can go through and do it as a grid if you like. You want me to do it that way? Yes? Okay. I'll do it as a grid. Okay. Where am I? Here we are. So we're given 3.102 grams of Ca3PO42. What am I going to do next? Good, convert to moles. We have to convert to moles of anything. So how do I get to moles? Divide by the molar mass. 3, 0.18 grams, or 1 mole, of Ca3PO42. Okay, now what am I trying to do? I'm trying to find calcium, right? So I need to use my molar ratio of how many calciums are in this one compound. So for every 1 mole of this, Ca3PO42, how many moles of calcium are in that? Three, good. 3 moles Ca. Now we need to convert back to grams because our answer is looking for grams of calcium. So we get 1 mole Ca equals the molar mass, which is 40.07 grams. And that equals 1.2, at least it should. Does that make sense? So I set it up different because this, yes, it's logical progression, but this is also just a simple ratio because it has to combine in the same ratios. Does that make sense? All right, can I move on? Take this away. Awesome. All right, chemical reactions are often studied at 25 degrees Celsius. What is the temperature in Fahrenheit? How do we calculate Celsius to Fahrenheit? We're going to use simple formula. We're going to just plug in 9/5 degrees Celsius plus 32 equals degrees Fahrenheit. Remember this from chapter 1? No. All right, so we have our degrees Celsius, which is 9/5 times 25 plus 32 equals Fahrenheit, and that should be 77 degrees. Cool? You won't be given it. So if she asks a question like this, then you need to know. Okay? What is the oxidation number of each atom in sodium perbromate? So how do we do assign oxidation states, more recent stuff? We have our compound Na, Br, and O4. There's our compound. What is the oxidation state on group 1A? First column. 1. Good, I heard it somewhere. Plus 1. Always plus 1. What's the oxidation state on oxygen? Negative 2. Good. There are 4 of them, so what's the overall oxidation state on the oxygens? If there are 4 of these and each one has a negative 2 charge, what's the overall charge? Negative 8. Good. So negative 8 plus 1 plus whatever this is, we don't know, x equals 0, because there's no overall charge. So we have negative 7 plus x equals 0, negative 7 plus 7 equals 0. So this one has to be plus 7 for it to be balanced. So our oxidation states are respectively 1, 7, negative 2. Question? Negative 8? Because there are 4 of these, and each one has a negative 2 charge. Cool? Make sense? Can I move on? Yes, no, maybe. Question? For what?
Because each one, we're looking for the oxidation state of Na, Br, and O, not O4. Okay? It's just each single one. Yes? The what? Because plus 1, so we have a positive 1 from this one. We have 4, negative 2, okay? So we have negative 8 plus 1 is negative 7, and it has to equal 0 over all because there's no external charge. So negative 8, or negative 7 plus 7 equals 0. So it's whatever it is to balance that out, okay? Can I move on? It takes 11.2 kilojoules of energy to raise the temperature of 145 grams of benzene from 25 degrees to 70 degrees. What is specific heat of benzene? Specific heat, what formula am I going to use? Good, we're going to use Q equals mcat. So Q equals mc delta T. So, just plug in numbers. We have 11.2 kilojoules. 0.2 kilojoules equals mass. What's my mass? It's okay to talk. It's good. Good, 145. 145 grams times specific heat. What's my specific heat? I don't know, right? That's what I'm looking for. See? Delta T. What's my delta T? Initial minus final or final minus initial? Good, 70 minus 25. And then just solve for C. So what is C? So we have 70 minus 25 is what? What? 45? 45 times C times 145 equals 11.2 kilojoules. What does C come out to be? Is anybody doing it or am I just?
I got 0.001716.
You got 0.001716? And this is in units of kilojoules per grams times degree Celsius, because we have kilojoules, grams, and degrees Celsius. So what are our units in the answers? Joules. So just convert 1, 2, 3. There you go. Cool? Remember to keep your units in mind. Units are the most important thing, to be perfectly honest. All right, calculate the mass percent composition of oxygen in Al2SO3. The answers are actually on the second page. It's my fault, but whoops. So how do I calculate the mass percent? I need my molar mass, right? What's my molar mass of this? Somebody do that. Mass is roughly 342. Grams, and this is Al2SO4 3. Al2SO4 3. What has to go on top? What am I looking for? I'm looking for the mass percent composition of oxygen. So how, essentially, what percentage of this compound is oxygen based on its mass? So what's the mass of oxygen in this? What is it? 191.9. And this is grams oxygen in there. And then how do we find a percent? What do we have to do? How do we get, how did you get 191? Good. So we have a mass of oxygen from the periodic table of 16. So we have 4 of these in each compound, each one of these, and we have 3 of those.
So 4 times 3 is 12. Okay? So then it's just like finding your test grade. How much did you get right over the total times 100 equals your percent. And what does that come out to be? What? 56? 56% oxygen. Cool? Make sense? All right, let's keep going. Let me find my second page. Here we go. And there's the answer choice. 56. All right. Let's keep going. Solve the following with the correct number of sig figs, everybody's favorite topic. So what's the rule for multiplying and dividing? Multiplying, dividing, you get two options, yes. Good. Multiplying, dividing, smallest number of sig figs. So in this top, how many sig figs am I going to keep? The top. 2. Good. This one, least amount of sig figs. 2. So when you multiply these together, what do you get? It should come out to be 8.331 centimeters cubed. Because we have 3 centimeters. So I'm going to keep 2 of these. Keep your decimals. Keep the decimals. Use them in the calculation, but you know there's only 2 of them significant. Then I'm going to divide that by the sum of these 2 numbers. So what's the rule for adding and subtracting? What is it? Good, number of decimal places, least number of decimal places. So how many decimal places am I going to keep here? 2, good. So when you add these together, you get 17.238 centimeters. And I'm going to keep 2 of those decimal places, okay? So when I divide them again, we have 2 sig figs divided by 4 sig figs. So how many sig figs am I going to keep? 2 sig figs divided by 4. Am I going to keep 2 sig figs or 4 sig figs? 2, good, least number. So when I divide those, what do I get? I should get 0.48 centimeters squared. Okay? Everybody see this centimeter cancel makes it 2. There you go. Make sense? All right, let's keep going. What is the concentration of FeCl3 in a solution prepared by dissolving 35.0 grams of FeCl3 in enough water to make 275 milliliters of solution? So what is this problem really asking for? What's another name for concentration? Molarity, good. So we're looking for the molarity of this. What is the concentration of this prepared by that? So what's my formula for molarity? What? Molarity. Moles divided by liters. Moles of solute divided by liters of solution equals molarity. Because remember, the units for molarity are moles per liter. That's the moles per liter. So can I divide 35 by 275 and be happy with that? No, good. I have to convert this to moles and this to liters. So if I convert 35.0 grams FeCl3 to moles, 1 mole, and the mass is, I have it written down somewhere. Maybe I don't. What's the mass of FeCl3? Chlorine is 35, so what's the mass of iron? You think it's 162? All right, I'll go with that. 162 grams. Oh, is that just iron or total? Both. All right, good. So we have iron is, I'm just going to make sure, 55, 35 times 3. So good. equals, what does this come out to be? .2160 moles of this compound. And now we need to convert this to liters. How do we convert 275 to liters? Just move the decimal place over three times. So we have 275 milliliters to liters. Just go 1, 2, 3. You're in liters. So we're going to do moles divided by liters, 0.216 divided by liters, 0.275 equals, what does that equal? This is moles, liters, 0.785 molar solution. Cool? All right, let's keep going. For a particular process that is carried out at constant pressure, Q equals this, W equals negative 15 kilojoules, therefore, we have to make some assumptions about delta E and delta H, or E and H. What's delta E? Good, change in internal energy. So delta E equals Q plus W. And we have delta H equals what? Delta H equals what? What is delta H? Good, that's a change in temperature. But what's delta H? Heat. Enthalpy, heat. Same thing. So, Q. So what's delta H? What's delta H? Good, delta H is 125, and we need to find delta E. Delta E equals 125 kilojoules minus 15 kilojoules, and that equals what? I think it's 110, right? Kilojoules. So delta H equals Q, and delta E equals 110. Awesome? Awesome. Did I have a question? I think I'm just seeing things. All right. All right, when 30 grams of benzene reacts with 65.0 grams of bromine, 43 grams of bromobenzene are obtained. What is the percent yield of bromobenzene C6H5Br, molar mass of that? So how do I do this question while I get an extra piece of paper? How am I going to do this type of question? Balance it. Good. First thing, balance the equation. So we're going to take a look. Six C's, six C's. We have six H's, Br, two Br's. Balanced. Okay? I'm going to just write this on a different sheet. C6H6 plus Br, 2 goes to C6H5. HBr. Okay, so next thing, write down your givens. We're given that when 30 grams of benzene, this is benzene, 30 grams of benzene reacts with 65 grams, 0.0 grams of bromine, and 42.3 grams of bromobenzene are obtained. I'm going to put this over here, and this is bromobenzene. So 42.3 grams are actually obtained. So that's my actual yield. Okay? So I'm going to go ahead and solve for my theoretical yield. So I'm going to convert how much product can actually be made or theoretically be made in this reaction. So I'm going to start with 30 grams of benzene What's my molar mass of benzene? Is it given? No, it's not. What's the molar mass of benzene? 12 times 6 plus 6. 12 times 6 is 72? Maybe? Yes? No? Yes? Plus 6, so 78? All right. So we have 78 grams C6H6, 1 mole C6H6. So now we have to use our mole ratio, which happens to be 1 to 1 in this case. So 1 mole C6H6 goes to 1 mole C6H5Br. Okay? So I want it in grams because eventually I'm going to have to need it in grams. So I'm just going to convert back to grams. 1 mole C6H5Br goes to 157 grams of bromobenzene. When you calculate that out, what do you get? While you guys are calculating that out, I'm going to start on the next grid. So we have to do the same thing for both of these products to figure out which one is the limiting reactant and which one is going, or which one's the limiting reactant, which one's going to be excess. So we have 65.0 grams of Br2. What's my mass of Br2? I'll look at the periodic table. We have Br by itself is 80, so 80 times 2 is 160 grams Br2. 1 mole Br2. So we're going to go ahead and use our mole ratio again, which again happens to be 1 to 1. What do I mean by the mole ratio? What? Good, the coefficients. So there's a 1 here and a 1 here. If there were 2 here, you'd put a 2 here. If there were a 1 there, you'd put a 1 there. So we have 1 mole Br2 goes to 1 mole of bromobenzene, which is C6H5Br. 1 mole bromobenzene goes to 157 grams of bromobenzene. What does this one equal? 60? 60. What does this one equal? Anybody get this one yet? And this is grams of C6H5Br. We have 58.8 grams of C6H5Br. Does everybody agree? No? 60 again? 60.78? 63.78, this is grams. So which one is my limiting reactant? Benzene's limiting because it runs out first. Okay, so this is my theoretical yield. We already were given our actual yield, so to find our percent yield, we do actual over theoretical times 100, which equals actual, which is 42 point something, 42.3. over theoretical, which is 60 grams times 100 equals what? 70 what? 70? 70.5, I think I heard, percent. And there you go. Does this make sense? It's okay to ask questions. Ask them now. Yes? Everybody good? I see some confused faces. Yes? This is my percent yield. So this is what the question was asking. We're seeing how much, or what is the percent yield if in a lab we did this experiment and we got this amount. So we're trying to find what efficiency the reaction happened at. Okay? You know, it really hurts to hunch over like this too. Man. Anyway. All right. Let's keep going. How many protons, neutrons, and electrons? This is chapter 2, I think. How many protons, neutrons, and electrons are in the bromide ion Br79 minus? What is this number? Remember in the symbol, if just a generic element, we have charge. This is mass. And this is atomic hashtag. Atomic hashtag. All right? Atomic number. So we have our mass here. The mass is equal to what? What weighs something in an atom? Or what weighs something that we count? I heard something. I could not make that up. What? Protons and neutrons, I think I heard from two different people. So this is protons plus neutrons. Protons plus neutrons equals the mass. Atomic number is just a fancy name for what? Protons, good. So atomic equals P plus. And the charge is what? The charge tells you what? Good. Electrons. Charge tells you how many electrons, okay? So how many protons, neutrons, and electrons are in here? So how do we find out? What's the atomic number of this? How do you find it? You look at the periodic table. Good. So we have 35. That's directly from your periodic table. So how many protons are in this? How many protons are in this? We just wrote it out. Atomic hashtag equals what? Protons. How many protons?
35.
Good. So you can eliminate every other one that does not have 35. Now you're down to two options. So we need to find neutrons. So we're going to do our mass equals protons plus neutrons. In other words, our mass minus our protons equals our neutrons. So what is our number of neutrons if we do mass minus our protons? 44. Good. So here's your answer. And electrons, we know we have a minus here. So we have one more electron than proton. So 35 plus 1, 36. Cool? You want to keep going? All right, let's keep moving. What time is it? How many sodium ions are contained in 99.6 milligrams of Na2SO3? So again, this is the stoichiometry game. I'm going to use a different sheet of paper again. So we start with 99.6 milligrams of whatever the compound is, which happens to be Na. 2SO3. So I'm going to go ahead and I always convert to grams because I don't want to deal with millimoles or anything weird like that. So how many milligrams are in 1 gram? 1,000, good. 1,000 milligrams at 1 gram. So now I'm going to go ahead and convert to moles. So what is the atomic mass of this? Good. I'm just going to go with 126. On your tests, keep as many decimal places right now. For my purposes, it doesn't matter. 126 grams of this, Na2SO3. 1 mole, Na2SO3. So we're going to keep going on this. So we need to convert this to ions. So how do we get to ions of something, or we're looking for sodium ions. What are we? There are two ways to get there. What? Good. We're going to use Avogadro's number. But in the this case, there are two ways to do it. You can do this step first or second. So there are 2 moles of sodium for every 1 mole of this. So 1 mole, Na2SO3, is the 2 moles Na. Okay? Because of that. There are 2 atoms per this compound. So every 1 mole of this, there would be 2 moles of that. And now I have to convert to ions. So we're going to use our mole number, Avogadro's number. 1 mole Na, 6.022 times 10 to the 23rd ions. And that equals, I don't know what that equals. Somebody calculate that for me. What did you say?
9.5.
Times what?
Times 10
to the what?
20.
20. All right, cool. So let's take a look at our answer choices. It's on the next page, actually, I think. Yeah. Again, formatting error here. So we have 9.52 times 10 to the 20. Cool. So we just go ahead and convert. If you need to get to something, you know, in Chem 1, there's only so many things you can do. All right? All right, let's keep going. So we're given this equation has a delta H value of this. Find the delta H value for this formula. So what's happening to this formula? If you notice, the products are where the reactants are, and the reactants are where the products are. So what does that do to our delta H value? Good. We multiply it by -1. It's already negative, so it's going to become a positive. And then if you notice, the coefficients are halved, I think. There should be, yeah, they're halved. Okay? So we're going to go ahead and divide our delta H value by 2. So 101... or 110.2 times -1, or -110.2 times -1 is 110.2 divided by 2, we get 55.1 kilojoules. This is kind of a simplified Hess's law problem. Does this make sense? Yes? Okay. I need the verbal confirmation, otherwise I just get some weird stares. Yes. What? It's times. It's, you know, the old symbol for multiplying. Elementary school. Everybody uses a dot or something now. Whatever. Yes. Can I do this one again? Yes, I can do this one again. So we have our equation, which has a delta H value of this. Okay? We have a second equation, which is similar to the first. We notice the products are where the reactants are, so that changes the delta H value. It changes which way the reaction is going. So if it's exothermic going one way, it's going to be endothermic coming back. So we change it from positive to negative, or negative to positive. So that's why we multiplied it by -1. We just change the sign. And then if you notice, there's half the amount. We have half. So if you notice, there's 2 of these here, 1 of those there, 2 here, or 2 here, 4 there, it's halved. So we divide, there's not as much, so we divide it by 2. Does that make sense? Cool? Yes. I'm dividing this number, so we're given a delta H value. So we're given a delta H for this equation, 4NO2 plus O2. 2N2O5. There's our equation with our delta H value of -110. Okay? What type of reaction is this? Endothermic or exothermic? Finally can walk. What type of reaction?
Exothermic.
What? We have endothermic. We have exothermic. Who agrees with endothermic? Raise your hands. It's okay. Who agrees with exothermic? We have more, but still not everybody. Okay, so this type of reaction is an exothermic reaction. Think of exothermic as exit. So energy is leaving the reaction. So you're going to have a negative value associated. Okay? Endothermic is entering, so you're going to have a positive value associated with it. So if I flip this equation around, if I put this where the products, N2O5, for 2, NO2 plus O2. If it's giving off energy one way, if this is giving off energy one way, the other way, it's going to be taking in energy. Okay? That's why we changed the sign on this. So this delta H value equals 110 kilojoules. Okay? And now we have, from this equation, we have half the amount of reactants and products. So our delta H value is going to be halved. So from going from there to there, O5 goes to 2NO2 plus 1. So we have delta H equals 55. Because they're half the amount of stuff. If I burn two logs, it's going to burn brighter than burning one log, right? So it's going to give off less energy. In this case, take in less energy. Make sense? All right. Let's keep going. What is the net charge for an ion with 33 protons and 36 electrons? How do we find this out? So we're going to do, this is chapter 2 again. We have positive. So our charge equals protons minus electrons. Easy. So we have protons, 33, minus 36, equals negative 3. So our overall charge is negative 3. Okay? What mass of KOH is needed to make 400 milliliters of a 0.725 molar KOH solution? How do I do this problem? It's very similar to one we did before. Yes? So we do what? 0.725 divided by 0.4 liters? All right, let's take a look. So what's our formula for molarity? Moles over liters. So we have our molarity. So just plug in for 0.725 molar equals moles over liters. So we have 0.4 liters. So we're just going to multiply these two. Okay? So my suggestion for this is always plug in what you have to your formula and then solve. Don't try to manipulate the formula before you solve the question. So when you multiply these two together, what do you get? What do you get? 0.29? So we have 0.29 moles of KOH. Okay? Now the answer choices are in grams, so again, it's a stoichiometry game. 1 mole equals my molar mass, which is, I have it written down, 56 grams. And that equals 16.3 grams of KOH. Do you guys kind of see a pattern to everything we're doing? Everything has to do with the mole ratio. Everything has to do with stoichiometry. It's just, again, if you're ever stuck on the test, just plug in what you got. It's to something. Eventually something will work. Okay? All right, let's keep going. What time? All right, we'll do like 15-ish more minutes on this if you want to keep going on this, and then we can go over test questions. Everybody good with that? I need your input at this point. Yes, okay. Calculate the number of moles in 0.901 grams of water. Does everybody know how to do this problem? Moles from grams, we're going to do grams times molar mass in grams to 1 mole of water. And that's how you get it. And the answer should be 0.0050 moles. Do I have to write it out? Would you like me to write it out? It's okay. Yes? All right, we got a yes. All right, so we're given our, I have my piece of paper. There we go. Okay. So we're given 0.901 grams of H2O times what's my molar mass of H2O? 18. 18 grams H2O, 1 mole H2O. Multiply that across, you get 0.00500 moles H2O. Good? All right. How many copper atoms are contained in 896 grams of copper? How many copper atoms are contained in 896 grams of copper? We're going to do same thing, 896 grams Cu. What's my molar mass of copper? 63.5? 63.5, okay. 63.5 grams, 1 mole copper. Now we need to use our Avogadro's number, 1 mole of copper, 6.022 times 10 to 23rd grams copper, or not grams, my fault, atoms, copper. And that should be, I haven't done that. When you calculate that out, what does it become? 8.48 times 10 to the what? 8.48 times 10 to the 24th. Cool? All right. After this, you guys will be experts in stoichiometry. Of the following ions, Ca2+, NO3-, Na+, Na+, SO4 are placed in a test tube. The precipitate that forms is what? So let's take a look. We have Ca2+, plus NO3-, plus Na+, plus SO4-2-. Okay? So let's take a look at what will form. I'm going to pull up the solubility rules. Hold on a second. I think they're here. We have our solubility rules. So if you get a question like this, sometimes it'll be in a reaction, sometimes it'll just have something. So write down all the possible compounds that can be made from these four. You'll have four possible compounds. So we have Ca, NO3-2, we have CaSO4, actually there doesn't need to be parentheses, but whatever, CaSO4, we have NaNO3, and we have Na2SO4. Na2SO4, so these are our four compounds. So we have to figure out which one's solid. So we're going to go ahead and take a look at our solubility rules, which are here. I'm going to zoom out for this. Okay. So, let's take a look. Compounds containing the following ions, lithium plus, Na plus, K plus, and NH4 plus, are generally soluble, so always soluble. Exceptions, none. So, compounds containing those are soluble. Soluble. I'm looking for the precipitate. Okay. Soluble. So now we look at the calcium ones. So let's look at SO4. When SO4 pairs with SR, BA, PB, AG+, or CA2+, the resulting compound is insoluble. That's what we're looking for. So this is SO4 pairing soluble or insoluble. So CaSO4 is our precipitate. This is just an exercise in reading this table. Does anybody have a question about the solubility rules? I believe you will be provided with this. Yes, question. Yeah, you should be. She's been giving it constantly, and honestly, I think there's only one chem professor who requires you to know it. So, don't remember. I'm not going to say even if I do remember. Anyway, ask me after. Regardless, you know, they might all now let you have it. But it's just read the chart, okay? If you were given a reaction, what would you do? If you were given two reactants, what would you do to find the full reaction? So if I was given I think I have a question like that, actually. We'll get to it. But it's for a single replacement reaction, you're just swapping it. For a single replacement, you're just kicking one partner off. For a double replacement reaction, which this would be, you're switching partners. Okay, so one positive is going to go with one negative is going to go with positive, the opposites. Okay? That made no sense in my head. Never mind. All right, let's keep going. Use the standard enthalpies of formation to calculate the delta H for this reaction. So how do I calculate a delta H value? I will zoom in, yes. I just felt you guys asking. Calculate the enthalpies, or use the given standard enthalpies of formation to calculate delta H for this reaction. So how do I calculate delta H? Good. Products minus reactants. That's it. So we're going to do whatever the enthalpies of the products are. So products, I kind of drew over it, but we have CO2, I'll just put, minus 393.5. How many CO2s do I have? Four CO2s plus how many H2Os do I have? Two, if you can still see that. Two H2Os, which is negative 241.8. Minus my reactants, which are 502. What's my enthalpy of formation for oxygen? Zero, good. So we don't worry about it because for an element, there's no reaction that forms it. It's just there. It's in its most basic unit. Okay? So we have that, and we have our C2H2, which the enthalpy is 227.4. How many of them are there? Two of them. Products minus reactants, and what do you get? Should get this if I calculated that right. Any questions on enthalpy of formation? H of formation. What? What? Products minus reactants. So whatever the H's of each product are, times the coefficient, you know, how many are there, minus the reactants. Sum of products minus sum of reactants.
Well, let's get the numbers.
Yeah, those will be given. You don't have to remember H of formations. Can I flip the page? All right. Next one is a percent abundance problem. You guys remember how to do percent abundance? Percent abundance. This is how you calculate your overall grade in your class. You scored this, that's how much it's weighted. You scored this, that's how much it's weighted. You scored this, that's how much it's weighted. Add them all up. So you'll see what I mean in 1 second. Not 1 second, but you know what I mean. So we have decimal percent 0.7899 times my percent abundance, which is 23.98. I'm not writing out all the decimals. Plus decimal percent 0.1000 times my weight, which is 24.985, plus decimal percent 0.1101 times 25.98259. Man, I wrote out all the decimals. When you add those up, you should get your percent abundance, or your average atomic mass. Not your percent abundance, your average atomic mass for this element. Did somebody do that in their calculator? Yes, no, maybe so. Yes. Perfect. I've been waiting for an excuse to use the board. All right. What? CSI. CSI, get it? What show does cesium and iodine like to watch together? CSI. Anyway. All right. That's enough of that. All right. So, let's say you have a class where you have a test. Tests are worth, so tests worth 80%. Homework, let's say homework is worth 10%, and quizzes are worth 10%. Okay, let's say you got a 29, or not 29, that'd be bad. Let's say you got a 79 on a test, you got 85 on your homework, and you got are, I don't know, 100 on your quizzes. You're good at quizzes. Okay, how would you calculate your grade in the class? Y'all will be doing this in like a week after your final. I know you will. So, you're going to multiply. Remember, all of the percents equal 100%. So I'm going to multiply the decimal percent, 0.8, times my score, which is 79, plus how much it's worth, 0.10, times my score, which is 85, and 0.1 times 100. What does that equal? Can someone do that real fast? Someone who's, yes, no? My calculator's over there, so I don't want to go get it. Anybody get score for the student? 81%. So we got an 81. They got an average of 81 points out of 100. Okay. Can I erase the student's test score? Yes? Okay. So now we have an element. How much it's worth, so this is 1, 2, and 3. This one is worth 78.99%, and it weighs 23.98. This one's worth, 10%, 11%. This one's weighted 24.98, and this one's weighted 25.982, whatever the decimals are. Calculate your grade. 0.7899 times 23.98 plus 0.10 times 24.98 plus 11.1101 times 25.982. Calculate your grade. 24.31 atomic mass units. Make sense? It's the same thing as you're going to be doing in a week. So the answer to that one is 24.31, according to everybody's calculations. Where did I put my pen? Did I? Oh, I threw it. I have another. Probably faster. Okay. Make sense? Good on this? All right, let's keep going. Balance the chemical equation given below and determine the number of milliliters of 0.003 molar phosphoric acid required to neutralize 35.00 milliliters of 0.00125 calcium hydroxide. What type of problem is this? What? Hard? This is a titration problem.
Everybody's favorite. All right. Let me grab a fresh sheet of paper. If I have one of those. There we go.
So the first, when you get a titration problem, I gave you a hint. It says first balance the equation. So how do we balance an equation? We just make sure that everything's the same on the left side as it is on the right side. Sometimes for the titration problem, they may not even give you the equation. So what is every titration problem going to start and end with? Acid plus base equals what? What? Water and a salt. Good. Acid, base, salt, and water. So if you notice, we have a acid, base, salt, water. Done. Okay. So I'm going to go ahead and rewrite the equation. CaOH2 plus H3PO4 plus HCPO4. These are aqueous, goes to Ca3PO42 plus H2O. All right? So how do I balance? What do I have to do to balance this equation? Let's take a look. How many calciums do I have on the left? One. How many calciums do I have on the right? Three. So what do I have to put in front of here? Three. Cool. So three, three, match. Let's take a look at phosphorus. There's one phosphorus on this side. We have two phosphorus on this side. So what do I have to put here to make sure those balance? Yes? No? What? How many, what number do I have to put in front of here? Two? Two phosphorus. Cool? So let's, now the calciums and the phosphorus are balanced. Let's take a look at everything else. So how many hydrogens are on this side? We have six here. Plus six, we have 12 hydrogens. 12 hydrogens. Let's look on this side. We have two hydrogens. What do I have to put here? Six. Good. Six. So now we have 12 hydrogens. Hydrogens balanced. Let's take a look at oxygens. We have three, or two times three, or how many oxygens? How many oxygens do we have in here? Six. Good. Two times three, six. How many oxygens are in here? What? We have four oxygens times two, eight, good. So how many are total here on this side? So we have four here times two, we have eight, we have two, six, 14. Let's take a look at oxygens on this side. How many oxygens do we have on this side? We have 4 times 2, 8, plus how many? Or plus 1, plus 6 times what? Or 6 times 1. We have 6 plus 8, which is how many? 14. Are we balanced? We're balanced. Cool? It's easier if you write it out. Everything, I was just trying to do it quicker and it ended up being slower, so next time I'm going to write it out. All right, so now, I'll get rid of that. Write down your givens. So we're given that we have milliliters, we determine the number of milliliters of this 0.003 molar phosphoric acid. So we have milliliters. Question mark. Required to neutralize 35 milliliters, so we're given 35 milliliters of this and 0.00150 molar of this. Okay? So how am I gonna find out how many milliliters of that am I required? What can I do? Any ideas? What? Good, we're gonna use the ratio, but we need it in moles first. So we're gonna use our molarity equation. Molarity equals moles over liters. So we have molarity, which is 0.0015 molar equals moles over liters, which is 0.035 liters. When somebody with a calculator, what does that come out to be? Moles. Huh? .025 moles. I don't think you're going to get numbers this small in the test. I mean to change this every year, but I never do. Just, you know, bear with me. So we have this many moles of CaOH2. And we found that from, we have our concentration, we have an amount, we can find our moles. So now, I'm going to use my ratio from moles to moles of this. So we're going to use 0.00, I could put in scientific notation. 5.25 times 10 to the negative fifth, negative 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. This is moles, CaOH2. Now I'm going to use my mole ratio since I'm already in moles. So 3 moles, that's why it's important to balance, CaOH2 is 2 moles, H3PO4. Mole ratio, easy grid, and what does that come out to be? Just this multiplied by 2, right? So this should be 1.025 times 10 to the minus 4th. Somebody verify that in our calculator, please. 0.05, not 25. Yeah. Times 10 to the minus 4th. This is moles. H3PO4. Does everybody agree? Did someone put that in their calculator and agree? What? 0.00 what? Oh yeah, you're right, it's divided by 3. So it's this divided by 3. What does that come out to be? 0.00035. 3 zeros?
There's 4 zeros and a 3.
3, 5 moles H3PO4. That's why I asked to verify. Okay, so we have moles now. So I like to make a little table here of Ca of each reactant. I'm going to move this up. We have CaOH2, and we have H3PO4. So what do we know? We know 0.00150 molar. We know 35 milliliters. We know 0.003 molar. We know we don't know milliliters, but now we know moles. We knew moles of this. 5.25 times 10 minus 5 mole. And this is 0.00035 moles. Okay, so now how am I going to find my milliliters from this? What did we do before? We're just going to use our molarity equation. So we have our concentration, which is 0.003 molar equals our moles, which is 0.00035 moles over liters, which are liters. So when I solve, what do I get? We should get liters equals 0.0116 repeating. So converting this to milliliters, we have 11.6 milliliters. 11.7, rounding up since it's repeating. Does this make sense? So summarize what we did. What we did was we balanced our equation. We wrote down what was given. Then what we did was we found our moles, amount of moles of our known, by using our molarity equation, which we got our moles. Then we converted moles to moles. And then we used the molarity equation again and found our liters. 4 steps. Questions on this? I know there are questions on this. Yes? Get the point what? It's 0.001 this. 0.00. So what I did was I multiplied liters. So you get liters times 0.003 molar equals this. Then divide by this. Divide by that. So this divided by that is that. Yes. Which ratio? For going where? For that? So when do we use that C1V1 equals C2V2 or M1V1 equals M2V2? That's for a specific type of problem. That's for a dilution problem. This is a titration problem. So for a dilution, you look for is diluted or made from or diluted with water. This, we're not diluting anything with water. We're using an acid and a base and actually causing a reaction. Okay? Does that make sense? All right. Can I keep moving on, or do we want to go over test questions now? Because we're past our 15 minutes. Test questions. Okay. Do you guys have your tests with you? Yes, no, maybe. I have my tests besides exam 2. I don't know where my exam 2 went. But I'd be willing to go over exam 2 questions if you guys have them. Any question? Also, on that site, I will post the answer key to this tomorrow. I just want you guys to give a chance to solving the rest of this. So I want to go over questions on this. Yes. Yeah, exam five. Sure, I have it somewhere. Yeah. Exam five. Here it is. Which extra credit? Not the Hawaii and Maine thing? Okay. I am going to ask, guys, before you leave, I have these things that I need someone to fill out. So can you guys, if you're going to leave now, just take one, fill in whatever, and, you know, just leave it here. So I'll just leave the stack on this chair. All right, extra credit number 22. All right, what type of problem is this? Hess's law problem, good. So calculate the delta H of four reaction using the given standard enthalpies of formation. So we have reaction here. So the name of this game is match and add. So we want to match the equations and cancel everything else. You'll see in a minute. Let me get a piece of paper out. There we go. Okay. We're going to play the match and add game. It's not a very fun game, but it's still a game. Okay. So I'm going to write down our reaction. 3H2 plus O3 forms 3H2O. 3H2O is liquid. States matter, so gas. Okay. So we have our reference reactions. We have H2 on this side, which is fine. So I'm going to go ahead and rewrite these reactions. H2 plus 1/2 O2 forms H2O, and delta H for this is negative 286 kilojoules. So we're trying to find the delta H value for this. So we want to match exactly. So I see I have three H2s here. So I'm going to multiply this whole equation by 3. So this becomes 3. This is 3/2. This is 3. And I have to multiply this number by 3. Okay? So our second equation here, we're going to match again. This one's just going to be used to cancel. So I know I have 3/2 of this, and what is in the equation I need? I need O3. Okay? Actually, here's O3. So O3 has to be on the other side of the equation. So we need to flip this equation. So we have 2 O3 goes to 302. And our delta H, this was the original delta H, 271 kilojoules. So since I flipped the reaction, I'm going to flip the sign. Flip the reaction, flip the sign. Okay? So how many O3s do we need in this equation? In this equation? What? 1, good. So there are 2 here. I just divide the whole thing by 2. So I divide this number by 2 as well. Since I flipped the equation, flipped the sign, and now I'm going to make this 3/2. I'm dividing everything by 2. So I'm going to write this a little neater. So we're trying to match this equation. So now we have 3H2 plus 3/2 O2 forms 3H2O. And we have O3 goes to 3/2 O2. And we have our enthalpies after manipulation. So 3 times negative 286 kilojoules. And we have negative 271 kilojoules over 2. Thank you. over 2. Okay? Now we're going to check to make sure that the numbers we manipulated here match that equation. So now I'm going to cancel everything and drop it down. So this cancels with this. See, those are exactly the same across the equal sign. Okay? Now I'm going to add these together. So this is 3H2 plus O3 forms 3H2O. Does that look like that one? Yes? Now you're going to add these two numbers together. This is there. Add those two numbers together, and what do you get? Can someone do that in their calculator for me? Otherwise, I have my calculator, I can do it. Did someone do it, or no? Negative 93, does everybody agree? Is that one of the answer choices? I don't think so. Negative 993, I gotcha. Minus 993.5 kilojoules, which approximates up to negative 994 kilojoules. Okay? This is kind of like the worst Simon Says game ever. Match the equation, add them all together. Cool? What other test questions? Yes. 18 from the same test, and then we'll go to yours. We'll do 18 first on test 5, then 22 on test 4. Test 5's over here. Yes, please. Take them and fill them out and put them in the pile there. Okay, so we have number 18. A 32.5 gram iron rod initially at this temperature is submerged into an unknown mass of water at 63.2 degrees Celsius in an insulated container. Find the final temperature of the mixture upon reaching thermal equilibrium is 59.5 degrees Celsius. What is the mass of water? So what equation am I going to use? I'm going to use Q equals mCat. So first you have to know that Q for the iron plus Q for the water equals 0. Okay? That makes sense because if you submerge, here's my beaker, whatever I'm submerging it in. Here's my iron rod. The iron rod is hot or cold relative to the water? The iron rod starts at what temperature? The iron rod, a 32.5 gram iron rod, initially at 22.7 degrees Celsius in a mass of water, in an insulated, what is the final temperature of the mixture is this. Okay, so we have a temperature initial for the iron, we have a temperature final total. Is the iron going to warm up or is it cooling off? What's the final temperature? 59. What's the initial temperature of the iron? 22. Is it higher or lower? It's lower. Good, so the iron is heating up. So we know that whatever energy the water is giving it, the iron is taking. So that's why Q for the iron plus Q for the water equals 0, because there's no energy leaving this container in this situation or entering this container besides what's in there. Okay? So we're gonna go ahead and write down what we're given. So Q for iron equals M 32.5 grams, okay? We're looking for mass of water, so that means we have our specific heat capacity somewhere. Is there a table in the front of this with the specific heat capacity? There should be. We have specific heat of common some common substances. Iron is right here, 0.449 joules per gram degrees Celsius times 0.449 joules per gram times degrees Celsius times our delta T. What is my delta T here? What? Good. Good. Final minus initial. My final temperature is 59.5 degrees Celsius minus my initial, which is 22.7 degrees Celsius. Okay, cool. Oh, and the water is 62.2 degrees Celsius. That's the original for the water. So you know it's hotter than the iron. Okay, so we have Q for iron. Now we need the Q for the water. QH2O. So we have an unknown mass, so x grams, times specific heat capacity for water, which is 4.184 joules per gram times degrees Celsius, times temperature final, which is 59.5 degrees Celsius, minus temperature initial, which is 63.2 degrees Celsius. Cool. So we have our unknown here. Can someone plug this part into their calculator and give me the Q for iron? So I'm just going to keep it in without decimals. So right now, just keep decimals on your exam. 537. And this is joules, right? Yeah, joules. So this is our Q. This is iron, Q iron. Plus my Q for the water. Here's my Q for the water. What? Someone say something? Oh, never mind. Q for the water, which is some unknown grams, x grams, times 4.184 joules per gram times degrees Celsius. What's 59 minus 63.2, or 59.5 minus 63.2? Negative 3.7 minus 3.7 degrees Celsius equals 0. And now you just solve for x grams. Dr. Beasley says use Q equals negative Q. This is the same thing, but I'm always going to screw up the negative because I always do. So just remember Q plus Q equals 0, because any energy that the water is giving the iron is contained within that system. So it all equals 0. So when you go ahead and solve this, what do you get? What's my mass for the water? We get 34.7 grams. Questions? Did that answer your question on this problem? Yes? All right. What question? Exam 4, you said? Number 22. This is exam 4. Number 22. A reaction mixture initially contains 15.7 grams antimony and 17.3 grams of sulfur. Once the reaction has occurred as completely as possible, what mass in grams of excess reactant is left over? Okay? So, what am I going to do first? What do you always do with any type of this problem? Givens, right? Well, first, make sure it's balanced. Is it balanced? Yeah. Then write down your givens. So I'm just going to go ahead and rewrite the problem down here. 2SB solid plus 3 sulfur solid goes to SB2S3 solid. Okay. So we're given 15.7 grams of antimony. That and 17.3 grams sulfur. So now we have to find what our theoretical yield is in order to figure out what's going to be left over. We need to find our limiting reactant to figure out which one's going to be in excess. So I'm going to go ahead and solve, pick a product. There's only one product. There you go. And I'm going to do the same thing. So we have 15.7 grams of SB. What's my molar mass of SB? Molar mass? What? 1 to 1.7 grams SB, 1 mole SB. So we're going to use our mole ratio, 2 moles to 1 mole, 2 moles SB, 1 mole SB2, S3. So we're going to use our mole ratio, and now I'm going to go ahead and go to, actually I don't really need to. I'm going to leave it right where it is. So what does that come out to be? .0645 moles of this product. I'm not going to write it down because it's understood. So now we have 17.3 grams of sulfur. What is the molar mass of sulfur? I think it's 32. What did it say? 32? 32 grams sulfur, 1 mole. Same thing. 3 moles sulfur is to 1 mole. SB2 S3, which equals, when you plug it in the calculator, what do you get? 0.802. Okay, 0.1802 moles. Okay, so which one's smaller between these two? That doesn't exist. Which one's smaller? The first one. Good. So we know that this is going to be our limiting reactant because this is going to run out first. That's the max amount of product that this can make. So which one? So I'm going to cross out this number because I'm never going to use it again. So I just want to make sure I'm never going to use it again. So this is the maximum amount of product that this reaction can produce. So which one's going to be in excess? Which one's going to be left? Sulfur, good. So we know sulfur is going to be left over. So I'm going to go ahead and take my theoretical yield, 0.0645 moles of my product, which is SB2, S3, and I'm going to go backwards to sulfur. So I use my mole ratio, 1 mole SB2, S3, 3 moles sulfur. Now I'm going to go to grams. So 1 mole sulfur is 32 grams of sulfur. What does that equal? 6.20 grams. Okay, so we have this number. So is this number the amount left over, or is it the amount used in the reaction? Good. This is the amount used in the reaction because we took the theoretical yield, which is the amount of product that this reactant can make, and we figured out how much has to react with this, and that happens to be 6.2 grams. So when we did this, when we went backwards from here on the theoretical yield to here, we figured out how much of this is going to produce that amount. Okay? So this is how much is used in the reaction. So to find how much is left over, we take 17.3 grams and subtract 6.2 grams. And that should equal 11.1 grams left over. Okay? What are the questions? Yeah.
For example, I have
Exam three, what, which question? What form do you have? You have A? C. So what is the question? I'll find it on A. What mass of what? Ah, got it. So I actually have this one solved out. So what mass of carbon is this one, right?
Yeah.
What mass of carbon is present in 0.750 moles of sucrose? So we have our given, which is 0.75 moles of sucrose. We're going to go ahead and convert that to moles of carbon. So for every 1 mole of this, which is sucrose, you have 12 moles of carbon, okay? That's why you can do 1 mole of the unit, which I didn't want to write out that full thing. I was being lazy, to be perfectly honest. Going to 12 moles of that carbon, okay? And now the answer choices are in grams. So I'm just going to convert grams or moles to grams. So 1 mole of carbon is equal to 12.01 moles, or 12.01 grams of carbon. So then you get 108. Okay? Cool on that? Where's my binder? What other question? Other questions? Yes. 21. Here we go. Ah, the combustion analysis. I'm going to zoom in so you don't see. Combustion analysis. So the combustion of 3.75 grams of a compound with a general formula of that CXHYOZ was burned completely in air, yielding 1.35 grams of water and 4.40 grams of carbon dioxide. What is the empirical formula of that compound? So what is the empirical formula? What is an empirical formula? What is it? Oh, gotcha. It is the formula that's in the most simplified format. What is the molecular formula then? It's the one that, you know, it has multiple ratios, okay? So we're trying to find how much or what actually this is. We have a general form. So for a combustion of anything, what is the general equation that it is for combustion? I know we've been doing this for an hour and a half, but bear with me. What's the general formula for combustion? Good. It's whatever, I think I heard it. It's whatever is being burnt plus oxygen, because remember the old candle glass jar experiment. You put that on top and the fire goes out. Whatever's being burnt, in this case your hydrocarbon, plus oxygen forms carbon dioxide and water, okay? So they don't have to give you the formula, you just have to know that whatever it is plus oxygen forms CO2 and H2O, okay? Yes? All right. So now I'm going to go ahead and write out what I'm given. I'm given 3.75 grams of this compound, some unknown compound, plus oxygen, which is in excess. If it's not stated, it's burnt in excess oxygen. I think it is stated too. Never mind. Completely in air. That means oxygen's not limited. Produces 4.40 grams of this and 1.35 grams of that. Okay? So now I'm going to go, I want to find how many moles of each thing there are. I set everything up on this problem. I never actually calculated it. So we'll see. So I'm going to go ahead and find how many grams of carbon there are and how many moles of carbon there are. Okay? So can someone put this into their calculator? 4.40 grams of carbon dioxide divided by 44.02 grams carbon dioxide. 0.099. 0.099, and this is moles of carbon. Okay? So we cross-canceled and we found moles of carbon. So now, can someone multiply that by 12? 99, and this is grams of carbon. Okay? Now we're going to do the same thing for hydrogen. Can someone put this in their calculator for me? So you have 1.35 grams of water. Molar mass to moles, 18.02 grams of of water goes to 1 mole of H2O. 1 mole of H2O goes to 2 moles of hydrogen. There are 2 moles of hydrogen for every 1 unit of water. So what does that come out to be? 0.1498. This is moles of hydrogen. It's a 9. Now, can someone multiply that by 1.01? It's going to be pretty close to the same thing. 1.51 grams of hydrogen. Okay, cool. Can we do the same thing for oxygen? No, why not? Good, they both have a carbon dioxide and an oxygen in it, but also the main reason is this. We don't know how much of excess oxygen is pulled into this reaction or how much is pulled from here. We just know that there is oxygen here. But we're also given that the original weight of this compound, the original mass, was 3.75 grams. And we have masses of each carbon and hydrogen that were used in this reaction. So what can we do to find out the amount of oxygen in that compound? Good. Subtract the 3.75 minus the sum of these two. What is the sum of these two? Can someone sum these together? 1.35. And this is grams. Grams. When you subtract these, what do you get? 3.75 minus 1.35. 2.4, and this is grams of oxygen in this compound. Now I need to find the ratios. So now it becomes more of an empirical formula problem. So I'm going to go ahead and convert this to moles. So I'm going to use the mass, which is 16 moles, 16 grams of oxygen, 1 mole of oxygen. What does that equal? 2.4 divided by 16. 0.15, 0.15 moles. Now, and this is oxygen. So I have my moles of carbon, moles of hydrogen, moles of oxygen. So now I'm going to divide by what? Someone said it, I heard it. Good, we're going to divide by the smallest number of moles. So which one here is the smallest number of moles? This one, right? So 0.099 moles. We're going to divide, it doesn't have, just divide everything by 0.099. We know this. I'll write it up here somewhere. 0.099. This is carbon. 0.099 equals 1.1498. And this is hydrogen divided by 0.099. 0.15 divided by 0.099, this is oxygen. What do these equal? They're going to be the same thing. What do they equal? What? 1.5. equals 1.5, and these are close enough to where I can approximate at 1.5. Are these whole numbers? Now I'm just going to multiply to get a whole number. What do I have to multiply all three of these by to get a whole number of all of them? 2. Good. So times 2 times 2 times 2, we get
equals
3, or 1, 2, geez, 2, 3, 3. So now we know carbon 2, 3, 3. Does that make sense?
Yes. The 0.099, that is the number. If you notice, I broke off these grids right here to where, can you even see that? Yeah, you can. Okay. So I broke off those grids there because this is the step where you get moles. So I want the moles of each one of these. And then in order to find out the chemical formula for it, I'm going to divide by the smallest number of moles to figure out the ratios in which they combine. So that's where the 0.099 comes from. It's the number of moles of carbon. Okay? Does this make sense? And I think that's the answer. There should be an answer choice to that right there. That's right, right? Should be. Unless we made some calculator errors. Let me look. Yeah, it's right here. C2H3O3. Cool? All right. At this point, I'm going to open it up for independent questions because there's 5 minutes, say 4 minutes left. So I just really appreciate you guys coming in. Can you guys fill this thing out, please? I'll put them over here so you don't have to come all the way up here. Are there any independent questions? I can pretty much talk without this thing now. Man. Is everybody ready for this test? Yes?
Hopefully.
Hopefully?
I will be.
You will be?
Was this helpful?
Yes.
All right, I appreciate
it. What are you doing with these numbers?
I have no idea. Leave those. I don't think you mark anything. It's just that. Just put them in the pile down there.
Thank you.
No problem. Yes.
So what's the easiest way to memorize this?
This?
Yes.
Okay. So to memorize that, I use the Quizlet. But also you could just, when you keep doing it,
you just memorize it.
Just do a Quizlet and that usually does it. There are plenty of polyatomic Quizlets.
Okay. Thank you for this.
No problem. Questions, comments, concerns. If you want to yell at me, fine. Yeah. Yeah.
I was trying to do it like an algebraic way, and it doesn't work out.
Try it again, because it should, where you distribute this and then distribute that. Okay, distribute in, distribute that, combine like terms, and there you go. Okay? Make sense?
Yeah.
Because if you do it, there should be one of these known, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, both of these are known.
I put in the values from the beginning, and then I was getting 27 instead of 28, and it was just like, it was in the back of the book, but
gotcha.
It just wasn't working out, and so I tried it the book way, and so not. I don't know what I'm doing.
Try it the other way again, mm-hmm. And just make sure you distribute the terms religiously, okay? That's all I can say, alright?
Alright, thanks.
Hey. Question?
There was like a problem you did, mm-hmm. 14, I believe. It was
in mine?
Yeah.
Okay. Which problem?
I believe it was this one. Like the one before.
No problem. Which one? This one?
14, yeah.
This? Okay, how many? I did it on a piece of paper.
Yeah, you did.
So how many sodium ions are contained? So there are two of these.
So NH2C? See?
Yeah, for every one unit of this, whole unit,